You see the title, we have the members of the committee are myself and the three people right here. She's going to talk for 50 minutes to an hour, then we'll take questions from the audience, then we'll do questions from the committee, then we'll send everyone out of the room, prompt, and then we'll have a celebratory lunch in an hour. All right, so go ahead.
So hi everyone, I'm Yasmin AlNoamany, and today I'm presenting using Web Archive, to enrich the life of experience using storytelling. And since I'm talking here about storytelling, I start with a story, personal story about me. So 5 years ago, something big happened in Egypt, so the Egyptian Revolution. And at this time, I was in the USA. And fortunately, everything, the work of the revolution started with Facebook. And sorry, I forgot to turn off the mic. I'm not sure you were hearing me or not, but can you hear me now better? Can you hear me now? Okay, better than previous. So, I was here in the USA when the revolution happened in Egypt, and but I was able to live and witness everything that was happening at this time over there. Yusuf, at this time, he was 2 years old, and I had this question in my mind, like, how he will know what's happening now? How he gonna live the past, like, what I'm watching right now as it's happening? So, I was relieved a little bit when I saw some people are taking care of documenting the revolution and generating many representatives about the Egyptian revolution. And also, there were some like books and studies that came afterward that cite these representatives and talked about the Egyptian revolution. But unfortunately, these representatives were gone. So no of these representatives is on the light book right now. So I started to worry again, how are we gonna know what happened in the past? So Salah al-Din measured how much of the resources disappeared, and he found that it's making
move
yourself. Okay, so that's better. So just give me one second. I think this should be fine. So we found that after 1 year, the social media resources about the Egyptian revolution, every person of these resources disappeared from the library. Luckily, we have the archive. Some people also took care of archiving these important representatives on archived collections. There is an Egyptian Revolution collection in a service called Archived, and I'll be coming to this shortly to describe to you what it is and what it is. So, archived collections are very important for future generations and also for our cultural heritage. But archived collections has many problems. What are these problems? So this is the interface of Archived that I talked like 2 minutes ago about. And as you see here, let me first describe you what it is. It's a subscription service from the Internet Archive, the oldest and the largest web archiving company. And it allows users to generate collections about specific or themed events and so on. So suppose that users will know about this after 10 years from now. And what he's gonna do is he will go and try to type some keywords about Egyptian revolution in this box over here, and he will write Egypt revolution. He will be presented with the collections that are related to the Egyptian revolution. So here, for example, there are 3 or 4 collections about Egypt revolution in Archived. So he will be presented by these different collections. But the question now, how or which one he will, should go through to know about the Egypt revolution? And if he select one, will it be easy for him to know or understand the holding of this collection or one of these collections and see what will happen. So this is, okay, suppose he chose this one, Egypt, Revolution and Politics, and he will choose the first URI, and then he will go through the first URI, and he will be presented with another list of mementos, in this, archived versions. It's called mementos, you're gonna find this later. And he will select one, and then it will show him this page here. And if you remember this page from my earlier slides, this one of the representatives that are looking, that does not exist anymore on the library. So it's hard for Yusuf to understand what happened in the Egyptian Revolution from browsing. He has to go through all the URIs and all the copies of these URIs and archive it. So collection understanding is not currently supported in archiving. So it's not easy to answer what's in these collections. So the problem becomes bigger actually when the topic is broader. And for example, here the human rights collection, there are about 17 collections about human rights. So if anyone wants to know which human rights is about women like in Africa or whatever, so it will be hard to browse all of these collections and go through all the URIs in these collections and browse their archive accounts. So these, I'm going to show you right now our early attempt for understanding these collections. So in the beginning, we tried to apply the conventional visualization techniques or methods for understanding the holdings of the collections. So we use like a different visualization here, like histogram and timeline and tree map. And all of these visualization gives you a good idea about what's the size of the collection, what's the time span of the collection. But actually, for understanding the collection, you still have to go and manually check each memento inside this collection. So these like best techniques, it may work, but for very like small set, and it won't work for understanding what's the holding of these collections. So these techniques are not applicable for understanding the collections. So any ideas? So we talked about storytelling, which become very famous now. So before going through storytelling and its problems, let me first define what story is. So a story in literature has many elements like setting, character, sequence, and so on. But stories in social media is just like arranging some web pages or resources through something. So we use actually stories with this definition, social media. So storytelling, as I have mentioned, like it became a very popular technique in social media. So there is an interest now for summarizing or selecting K resources out of N, where K is much smaller than N. So for example here, Facebook and the biggest social media company, actually Facebook and Twitter, Facebook was able to summarize all the resources in your timeline with the Facebook lookback, just 1 minute video, and also there's a Twitter story. So what are the limitations of storytelling services? So this is a story part, and it's very the most famous web storytelling services allow users to select resources search social media content and drag and drop resources to create or generate narratives for a story. So this is the Egyptian Revolution on Storify, and here, suppose that you are reading this story and you want to check a link inside this story. So you will click on this link, and okay, this link does not exist anymore. So the resources in social media disappear. So this is the problem of the storytelling in social media. So despite these limitations in social media and web archiving, how do we combine both of them to fix these problems? So what we're doing here, suppose that this is the web with all the content in the web. Archived collection is being created by some specific URIs from the web. So it's a smaller subset of the web. And then we have the story that we sampled from the archived collection, some web pages that represent the story. So we select these URIs and we put them on one of the social media interfaces, StoryPoint, for presentation. And this story here, I want to tell you a story. I have generated those manually from the Egyptian Revolution collection I spoke about in the beginning, archived, and I took many hours in generating these. So I went through the collection, I browsed many URIs to be able to select these URIs and to put them in this interface. So hopefully this will be saved for Yusuf like in future, so we can see them. So, okay, I took like many hours in generating. How do we do this automatically? So this is our main question here that we have solved in this presentation. And this is, can be divided into sub other questions. So we have here 5 questions. The first one, how do people use web archives? And then can we generate the stories from web archives? And then we have like how do humans generate the stories and what are good stories looks like? What's inside the archival collection? Then 4, we have how to identify the off-topic pages in the archives. Then 5th question is how to identify and evaluate set of web pages that support the story. So before going through how we handle these questions, I'm going to show you first some terminologies that I'm going to use in the rest of the presentation. So the first one is the URI art, and this is the page as it appeared on the live web. The second thing is a memento or URIM, and this is a snapshot of a URI. So for example here, we have CNN and we have different covers for CNN and Fruitline. So these are mementos of CNN. Time map is a list of mementos for the URI art, and time map, there's many human readable visualization for it, so for people to browse. These are some of the related work that formed our foundation, the foundation of this work. So the first research question, how do people use web archives? So we were lucky actually to have access for terabytes of access user access logs from the biggest and the oldest web archiving company, the Internet Archive. So we took sample of these logs and we analyzed it, and we identified 4 different patterns for these logs. So the first one is diffs. This is when the user come and just like make one hit and then navigate away. And this can be to a time map or memento. And then dive, he go through from page 1 to page 2 and at roughly the same time. And slide is where the user like choose a specific page and he browse different tabs of this page at different times. And then scan is where like they just download or get some time maps, different time maps. So we found that humans do a lot of this and robots do the same. I'm going to show you like, So we have, based on our analysis, we discovered that robots outnumber humans 10-1 for accessing the Wayback Machine. The access actually is the Internet Archive Wayback Machine receives like around 82 million requests a day. So most of these requests are from robots. So we can conclude from here that web archives are hard to browse or hard to be discovered. So for humans. Also, 64% of the time that the human visits the Internet Archive, Wayback Machine, they visit just one page and then they navigate away. So even they know about the archives, they just, maybe they can't use it like this. It's not easy for them to use it. We also have done another study to study the linking to archives, like how the people link to our archives and where they come from and why they do come to the web archives. And the interesting thing here is that 82 of the human sessions that comes to the Wayback Machine comes via referral from the live. That means, there are some links that refer to the Internet Archive to show that brings the people to Internet Archive. So they don't come via direct channels. So we conclude from these studies that web archives are hard to use and they need tools to help the people to use web archives and also to bring the people to the archives. So the second research question here we have have in regionally like different stories that represent the collection. So archival collection is two dimensions, URIR and time. And each of these URI and time can be fixed and can be sliding. And I'm going to show you each type of example. So the first type here is if for a specific point of time and for a single page, and the page can have many different versions. So for example here, this is the same page, but the representation of the page is different between how the page is being accessed from desktop or from mobile. And also the GUIP, if I'm here in California, when I access something, maybe the representation is different than if I'm access Google, for example, from Asia. So the second type here, if we select a specific URI and try to see how this URI evolved, or how the story evolved on this URI through time. So for example here, this is a CNN blog page, and here, you know, at different dates, by looking at this picture, you can see how the Egypt Revolution story evolved over time, starting from, you know, the CNN, the first one, February 1, they shut down the internet, and until Mubarak quits at the end. So just looking at the picture, you can get a feel of the story. The third one here is we can like select a specific event and through time, or a specific point of time, and see how the coverage of newspapers for this event. So for example, I choose here Mubarak resigns at that, and I choose here like February 11th to see how the newspapers covered this event. So see in here, okay, Mubarak is now joining Cairo, and we have here BBC, also Mubarak resigns. There is another, like the one at the top here, Justin from CNN, it's Mubarak quits and how the other countries react. So the first thing here is the first type of story is, and this is the broadest coverage of the collection and the most general case. And this is where you provide the summary for the whole collection and disregarding to which URI or which at which time. So for example here, this is the story of the Egyptian revolution, but this is from different websites at different times. You can see here that there are many different times, and here you can see BBC, CNN, and some other blogs, and so on. So for generating these stories, we introduce and propose the dark and the stormy archives framework. And this framework has three main components. The first one is establishing a baseline of how the human generates stories, and also what's inside the archive collection. And then the second component is reducing the candidate pool of archived pages by removing the relevant pages and the duplicates and so on. And then how to select from the rest of the pages a good representative pages from the rest of the page. So that brings us to the third research question here, which forms the base of the pyramid. Establishing a baseline for how the human generated story look like and the characteristics of archive collections. So here we will start with establishing a baseline of social media stories through a study we have done on StoryPy. And here we want to know how good story look like to form a foundation for our framework for the generated stories from our framework. So we quantified many stuff here, like for example, the number of resources in the story, what are the resources, like what's the type of the resources in the story. Sometimes I'm strong too, so I click once, it depends too. So what are the most frequently used domains? And these are the results of the most frequent domains here, and it's very interesting because you can see here that Twitter dominates the top 25 with 82%. And also, most of this list are for social media sites. So then we measured, we measured what differentiates a popular story. You want to see how as a good story look like, so we can use it as a template for our generated stories. So based on the views of the story, we selected the top 25 stories with the most views and to be the popular. And here we saw the different elements, but I want you to focus on a specific stuff that we measured here. So the number of elements, the popular stories tends to have more elements than the unpopular stories, with median 28, and this is an important number, remember it for later. And also they tend to have more editing time than the unpopular stories. Also, the decay rate of the popular stories is lower than the decay rate of the unpopular stories. So, the conclusion, the thing I want you all to remember here is that we found 28 mementos, resources for the stories is a very good number for the our future generations. So not future, so our DSA. So next we check what's inside the archived collection, because this is what we will sample from. So we measured also what are the URIs in the collection, and how many like seeds or how many mementos per URI. And also, what are the top domains, like what we have done with the story for. And in the collection, something was different. So here, the top 25 is much different than the top 25 of story 5. So here, the first one is for a government, Canadian government website. And also, you can see that the many like government and educational websites like dominate here the top list. And also Twitter here is number 10, it's not number 1, with a very low percentage, 1% only. So we concluded from here is that the resources and web that the users use in web archives are different from a different subset from the web than the resources in the stories. So first research question here is how to detect or identify the off-topic pages in web archives, and this is for the middle part of the pyramid. And so here, first, detecting the off-topic pages. Archive provides their partner with some tools to generate collections. So for example, if you are a partner with Archive, you can generate your own collection, select seed URIs from the live web, and you can just archive these URIs. So they also provide you some tools to tell you what are the mechanics of HTTP. And like the type of the domains and so on, you know, and the status code of the URIs and so on. But unfortunately, there is no currently content based tool that tell you when these URIs goes off topic. And I want to show you the problem or the effect of this problem with this example here. So this is the time map in the Egyptian Revolution collection. It's for a guy who was running at. Election. This time map here started as octobic in 2012, and then it went octobic, and then it went octobic again because of financial issue. You have to believe me here, because I'm the only one. No, not the only one who knows Arabic. And then it goes octobic again, and then it goes octobic because the website hacked, and then it goes octobic because the domain is not posted. So actually, over 60% of this time map has are octobic. So imagine this time map for the general web archive, it's okay to be saved. So it documents like how the page changed over time. But for our generated stories, it's not. It won't be something good that the selected pages at the end will be have something like this memento. So what we want to keep for our framework are the relevant mementos only. So how do we detect these pages automatically? So we have investigated here six different methods. A set of them depends on comparing the textual content, and one depends on the semantics of the content, and then the last set of methods depends on the change of the structure of the pages. So the first set of methods here, so these two pages have changed, like this page, the other page changed, but stay on topic, so similarity is fine. And but these two pages in the bottom, they changed, but the other one, it went off topic, this is an interesting method here, because sometimes the beach flow time changes dramatically, and actually they still like in the same topic. So for example here, these two pages, so I think everybody here can tell that they are about Egypt, and they are fine to be included in the Egyptian Revolution collection. But term-wise, they don't overlap. So what we have done, inspired by this technique, we have like took the top terms of the first page, and then put it on paint search, and extracted the snippet thickest, and then added this thickest to the previous list of terms of the page. So now you can see that new terms appear that correlate with the other page. So also we noticed that many of the pages that go off topic, like its structure, or there is a big change in its structure and its content length and so on. So we use these two methods, like word count and content length, for measuring or detecting the off topic pages. So we built a gold standard data set to evaluate these six methods. And okay, when I see this, I get tired, because I have manually done like 15,760 mementos manual labeling. Like, if you remember the time map I have shown you like couple of slides ago, and on topic, off topic, off topic. So I went like on all of these number of pages like this to manual label all of these mementos. So that's painful. I have done this for three different collections, and this is all the number of URIs, some from hundreds of URIs, thousands of mementos, and also to detect, I found like many or hundreds of off-topic mementos in these URIs. So this is an example of a manually labeled set, and definitely I would never do this again. So here's the URI and how it's labeled on-topic and off-topic. So based on the evaluation, we evaluated the six methods here at different thresholds, and also we combined the methods to see if combining the methods will bring us better results. We averaged the results over the three collections. So this is the results of testing or investigating the six methods, and as you can see here, the lower design is the best performing single method, and word count and design are the best performing of all. So like over the single methods and over the other combinations of methods. So we took the best two methods, and we like doing another level of evaluation. We evaluated 18 different collections at our pilot, and using these two methods at this threshold, like 0.1 and minus 85, we used different sets of like types of collections. Like, for example, we had like governmental base, and we have state base, and so on. The collections also were different in number in terms of the number of URIs and the number of mementos. So this is the results of evaluating the 18 collections, and as you can see here, we found that subset of the collections, they don't have any off-topic URIs or mementos. And also, there are many collections we found that I annotated with red. They have like around 15 to 20% of these of the mementos, and also they affected many URIs for these collections are detected as off-topic. So then, after detecting the off-topic, we like detecting the duplicates and time maps. So the collection creator set up the frequency of crawling the page, and this can be daily or even hourly or weekly and so on. So it happens that the page doesn't change and it kept crawling. So here, this is an example of a memento in the Egyptian Revolution collection, and it has these nine mementos actually has five duplicates. This is another example for an article, and the article you know, most probably it doesn't change. Only the change here comes with this side part that has the most recent or the related stuff. So these articles are near duplicates, and for this case, we consider the first memento. So we have an algorithm here for detecting the near duplicates based on empirically threshold. We like differentiate or say this is duplicate for now and for me. Really, I did it once only. So, yeah, this brings us to the fifth research question. How do I identify and evaluate like set of representative page to support the story? So this form the last part of the pyramid here, and this step starts with dynamically slicing the selection, and then we cluster the pages in each slice, and then we select high quality pages from based on quality metrics we have, and then we order the pages by time, and then we visualize visualize these pages using story part. So the first thing, how to divide the collections, how to divide or slice the collections. So, if you remember from the early of the slide, I have said that archive the collections is two dimensions, URIRs and time, and exactly here. So, this is what we expect that we're gonna found for these collections, like the operator has set of URIs and there will be a uniform shape of ruling of these URIs. Or, you know, specific structure, even if there are here some gaps in the middle, but it's just like little bit. But this is actually what we find. Okay. Now it doesn't work. So by two, it doesn't work. Maybe the battery.
Can you quit this application, restart, and try to cover
you didn't forget what I have said here. Okay, good. Come on. Usually it's not something that happens to a surprise in the wedding day, so no problem. Yeah. One of my friends gets her dress like burnt. So this is, I'm sure this is not worse than what happened to her. Like this myth, so gaps in the middle, some your eyes start rolling and some other your eyes start after and some end at specific time and some continue. So to cover this, we have like put a slicing algorithm that guarantee uniform representation of the slice, of the number of elements in the slice. So then after we slice the collection, we do cluster the moments inside each slice. We use a DB scan algorithm for doing the clustering because this doesn't need effects in its part right now. So so we use this algorithm because it doesn't know information about the number of clusters ahead. And we cluster the moments inside each slice. Then we select from each cluster a good representative page of this cluster that this page will be placed later for this way. So for selecting this page, we have like set some quality matrix here, and I'm going to show you each matrix with example right now. But this is the equation quickly that has everything, the weights of all the matrix we use. So as first quality metric here is the memento damage, and I have used my colleague Justin Cornell memento damage for computing this. So here, these two mementos, just like to give you an idea what this happened. These two mementos here, or two pages, can you tell me which one is better? The one on the right or the one on the left? Okay, so everybody can tell it. So, but in terms of the content and the textual content, comparing those pages, we can't know from this. So we have used Justin's method to automatically detect that the left one is better than the right one. Then for generating story, the snippet quality also is a big issue here. So we have used two metrics for snippet quality. So these two pages are represent the same event or talk about the same thing. But the one on the right provide better snippets, so we consider the ones that provide better snippets. And based on some like investigation, we found that we found that the deeper that you go with the URI level, the better the snippets you have. So this is the BBC page, and this is the one as a home page, and then it comes to the home page of the Middle East, and this is an article. So as you see here, this snippet has an image and it has a title and the text. So it's much better than the previous two snippets. We found also that the category of the URI affected the quality of the snippet. So this example here show it's the same category, social media. And we found that social media don't, the pages, social media don't bring good snippets because usually the extraction here is for the text, descriptive text of the pages, and not all the time it represents the topic of the collection. So for visualizing the story, if you recall my handcrafted story that I generated in the beginning for the Egypt Revolution, so let me zoom on one of them. Here you can see that list of snippets, the fab icon here, it's the same for all the snippets, and there's no pictures, and okay, let me tell you, I will tell you this is not the best thing until I really show you the best. But we override all of these stuff, and we have like generated another metadata and send them to Storyfy, and this is the generated snippet. So I think you can say tell that this snippet is better than the ones that I really worked hard to generated and extracting the URIs and so on. So this snippet here has dates and has better fab icons and all has images and so on. So revisiting the Egyptian Revolution example, this year you remember the three collections that will show up for Yusuf when he browsed archived. And these three collections, we generated a story from each collection. So here, this is the story from the Egypt Revolution of Politics. And if you read like from a quick browse for this story, you can know what's inside this collection. You will get an idea about what's the content of this collection from these snippets here. The second collection is the North African Middle East collection, and you can see that these studies represent other countries than Egypt, like you have here about Sudan, and you have about Yemen, and so on. So he can know from this story that this collection it's about other countries, not only Egypt. And this one here, it's an Arab Spring, and just this collection has one memento because what all happened to them is 5 URIs, 3 of them were ophthalmic, and one only URI has some mementos, and they are duplicates. So this was the result of the story from this collection. So now, how do we evaluate what we have done, the automatic generated stories? So we use mechanical analysis, mechanical filter, and those are human can like evaluate yourself. And to do these experiments and for comparing human generated stories and our automatic generated stories, and also we generated some stories randomly to evaluate, to like compare the stories against. We consider successful the evaluation is successful if the human generated stories are indistinguishable, or our generated stories are indistinguishable from human generated stories. We also consider the evaluation successful if our stories and the human generated stories performed better than the random stories. I'm going to show you right now how do we get the human generated stories, because this wasn't easy, but luckily we have like good friends at Internet Archive. So we provided the help of people from Internet Archive, or Archive, mainly Archive. We have here, we provided them with guideline documents on how to generate the story and how to select the mementos in the story. So like for example, we don't want mementos from outside the collection and so on. And this is the table that has the collections that we tested. So it has 10 collections, and as you can see here, it has like a very number of URIs and also different numbers, different number of mementos and so on. And but most of these collections actually are theme-based collections, or you know, cover specific topics. So for example, our famous Egyptian Revolution, and there is Virginia Tech Fighting Shooting here, and also Occupy Movement and so on. So we got 23 stories from expert archivists from the Internet Archive and other and their other partners from these 10 collections. This is an example of a story that we like. We got the links for, and then we like pushed to Storyboy. And this is the second type of stories, the automatically generated stories by the DSA framework proposed. So the first here, I'll look through this quickly. First, we obtained the CDURIs from Internet Archive interface, and then we extracted the HTML from the work files for the collections that we have published at ODU, and then for the other collections we downloaded from the Internet Archive. Then we extracted the text of the page, and then you know processed those text and to detect the ophthalmic page, and also the near duplicates and so on. And then we sized the collections dynamically, and then we applied some quality metrics to select the best representative pages for the stories, and then we visualized the stories by using Storyboy. So this is an example of the automatically generated story by the DSA framework. And I bet you can tell the difference between this and the previous one. Dr. Roy actually yesterday didn't tell the difference, right? So the other type of story we generated is the random stories. We selected 28 mementos randomly from all the time and the collection without excluding the off-topic and so this is an example of the random stories here, and you can see here some mementos are good and some mementos are not good, so it's random, you just get what you get. And this is here, we generated four stories here just as a control for the mechanical filters to control their selection. So if anyone selects a story like this, we reject their selection. So these are the number of resources that for the human stories and DSA stories. And you can see here on the top collections, the numbers are very close to each other, but for some collections, like the second line, the human has 16, and here our framework, and actually this collection had 30,000 mementos. So it's our framework provided, like summarized it in 45 mementos. So this is the mechanical turf experiment. So set up. So for each story, we had three hits or three comparisons. So that forms a total of 69 hits. And we assigned like each hit for 15 distinct master turfer. And we rejected the submissions that had the bad story, as it has shown you. And so we got this number of like valid hits, so around like 1,000. This is an example of the heads that the turfer evaluate, and this is shown here, two comparisons for each head. Each comparison has two stories next to each other, and this is not image, this is an HTML, so they can go deep and browse the story and, you know, scroll down, and they can also go like follow these URIs and see their mementos on the archive. So the average time taken by the turfer was 7 minutes, with the maximum also they went like maximum to 20 minutes, and as I have told you before that we rejected the submissions that took less than 10 seconds. Okay, the results, which is like we didn't wish something better than this. This is the human and human and automatic stories next to each other. So they were preferred by the turfers. They almost like 50%. And for the random and automatic and human and random, human and automatic performed much better than random stories. We zoomed like out on the types of the stories. And as you can see here, this is the automatic only versus human. For all the types of the stories, they are like, you know, 50-50, they are very close. This is the random versus human, and you can see here that human outnumber the random, like, with, you know, a huge percentage for all the types of the stories. That also for the automatic story versus random. So, that was a success. We couldn't, like, get better than this. So, DSA generated stories are indistinguishable from the human generated stories by domain experts. So I'm going to now revisit the research question from the beginning and see how or what are our solutions as a paper by each question. So the first one was, how do people access web archives? We identified four different patterns with slide dive and skim. And also we discovered that tropics outnumber humans 10 to 1. And 64 of the time, humans that visit the Wayback Machine, they just do dips or, you know, just browse one page and navigate away. And many of the of the humans that comes to web archives, they come via referrals. So here, the second research question was about if we can generate the different stories from archival collection, and we have used four types of stories based on the URI at the time being sliding or fixed. And also we presented the DSA framework for generating these stories automatically from archival collection. The third research question is how like good stories, human stories look like, and what are inside the archival collection. So we found that 28 is a good number for the number of resources for the stories. And also we found that Twitter dominates the top list, or the top most frequent 25 domains on Storyfile. We also, for determining the characteristics of archiving, we found that social media have less representation on the archives. So we can conclude that the resources that are being used in web archives and the resources that are social media stories are different subsets of the web. So how to identify off-topic pages from web archives? Here we have generated both that I labeled them manually, so I should be paid for this. And we evaluated 6 different methods for detecting these off-topic pages, and discovered that cosine similarity and word count combined represents sorry, performance the best. And we then evaluated these best methods on 18 different predictions to discover around 1,000 off-topic mementos and 400 targets. So the last question here, how do we evaluate and select representative pages that represent the stories? So we generated stories based on temporal clustering and memento quality, and then we with the help of our partners in Archivic, we built a gold standard data set of human-generated stories and 23 stories, and from expert archivists to evaluate our DSA stories against. So here the result have shown that the DSA generated stories perform like as or are preferred as the human generated stories for the mechanical tools. These are our deliverables. So we have like 3 sort of informal regional papers and 5 conference papers, and we have 12 student paper award in 2013, and we contribute to the community to gold standard data sets. So hopefully nobody will have the feeling that this. So our future work will continue toward enhancing the result as the results of the framework, first by recommending new CDRIs based on the archival and live web link analysis, and also expanding the off-topic tool to include the pages that start as off-topic. So by computing about the collection and so on. We also plan to collaborate with humanities people to see how these stories help humanities researchers for discovery and understanding tests. So what we have done to summarize, we have combined storytelling and archive collections to generate archive and enrich the stories. So hopefully after a couple of years, thank you for the DSA,
and thank you for listening. All right, first we'll have questions from the audience. Who wants to go first? Don't be bashful.
Yes.
So, slide number 65.
Oh, yes, sir. Actually, there's a mic here.
No, just restate. Can you restate the question?
Sure.
Thank you. So how do you see your work being required as an external service or as an add-on to one of the existing archives like Archive?
Yeah, I wasn't expecting this question from one of the committees. So he was asking me if, how do I see my work like deployed as an add-on on maybe archive interface or as external service. So this work should be add-on archive interface at the end. There should be a link under the collection, maybe next to the collection description that has link for these stories on the story part. So the curator should create this outline and have links for the stories on the archive interface. This is how we imagine how it will be.
Thanks.
Any other question? Yeah.
I have a question on 115 leading into 116.
115?
Leading into 116. Now, would you just do the next one? Could you just explain in a little more detail? Maybe I missed it. We talk about overriding the default metadata.
Yes. We override the pub icon because the story point, if you provide the link for a story point.
So okay. Actually, go to the next slide where I think it has an example, right?
Yes.
So point to the parts.
Okay. So here, story point, default situation here would, like for all DCRIs, regardless of the source, you will write here archive it. Because archive it is the first part of the URI. These are all mementos. So we override this. With the having the hub icon of the resource itself, like the original URIR, not the memento, so it can like provide you better visual instrument, and you can know like this is from New York Times, better than having them all from archive. We also have here the date, so this shouldn't be automatically by story point. We actually send the date and with the title, so it can. Can be better and provide the user, you know, like good like sense about the time of the story, of the URI of the story. Also, the pictures we here in the pictures we control the type of the URI that may provide better snippets. So based on the quality metrics we have, so that we choose the page that have like can provide pictures easier. So that affects how that most of these resources here in this story have pictures.
And what was the source of the data that you used to override? It's already within the page itself.
It's the source of the data that they.
Well, you said like you overwrote like pictures and you added dates.
Yes. Okay, I override what the Storyify API does. So yeah, we select set of URIs, and if I send these URIs to Storyify, or if you are a user to Storyify and you're gonna use the interface, this is what you will get. You know, it will extract the title automatically, and we have extract the text automatically and the hub icon. So we override, we push the story, we push the story with its metadata. So
but I think she's asking, where does that come from? How do you get the date? How do you get the icon?
This is what you mean? Okay, we use another tool for extracting the dates. There's a library that we use for extracting the date and the stuff in the title and so on. Okay. Yes, it's called the newspaper.
So Storyify doesn't have a time field or date field, so you have to put it in the title itself, like you prepend it in the
title. No, you can control the title. If you use the Storyify extraction, you can control the title. You just can control the top icon.
The question is, there's not a date field.
That's what I was asking. There is not a separate date field. That's why you want to find the title itself.
Exactly. Yeah. Sorry.
Other questions from the audience?
Question.
Yeah.
You looked at the archive collections and saw how you could then reach content to tell the system. Do you see your framework applicable? Live webs, for example, that's breaking and you want to find your way to summarize it. You see your framework applicable to content which is not in archive because it's just currently breaking.
Definitely. It will be much easier because here is the challenge here with the archive data is the time dimension. So we have to consider. So, but yeah, the part of the framework, like, yeah, it can be applied to any other data that's just a little bit different. So I think it will be much easier.
Other questions from the audience? This is your last chance to figure out what Yasmin's doing. She's going to get on a plane, go back to San Francisco. She's got a postdoc position at Berkeley. She's never going to talk to us again. So if you have any questions about her data or software or results, you need to ask them now. She's not going to take our calls anymore.
I like this pretty.
All right, so we'll transition to questions from the community members. Who wants to go first?
Well, I always ask this question for NPHD stuff. You have a lot of details and data and all of that stuff, but I would like Mr. Becker to tell me what is the intellectual contribution of your work? What is the reason where that you said I like to, you know, to relate, it's my own, I like to, you know, take the credit that I'm the first one who did it, no one else did.
Okay. Actually, I think I have summarized this in the slide that you use of after many years, he will thank me about helping him in understanding the archive, the collection, and creating this framework that extracts the stories automatically from the archive to collection, so he can know what happened in the past. So this is, the main thing or the main contribution of this work. So I hope I like say I should do.
I mean,
okay.
You know, there's something called the beta. Beta means
okay.
What is, you say, this? I am going to beta this concept, this idea, because nobody else thought
okay.
about it. So this, yeah. I would like to point out.
If I would like to.
So the algorithm you developed is evaluating. What is this intellectual contribution? You can claim it's my own, nobody else.
Okay, I don't know much about intellectual property, but I think this year it's mine. My main thing that I would, consider that I think nobody has done this before, as like this. The dark end, archives framework.
Second question, or another related question is, every story have many different versions. Like when I sit at night and I see CBS, NBC, ABC, then I come to something called public PBS. Somehow I feel the PBS telling the same story in a way I am really comfortable with.
Yeah.
So you can always get a story about something that fits certain perspective.
Yes.
User than the other.
Yes.
So how do I, how do I trust?
Okay, I can help you with this. I can help you with this actually.
Yeah.
So here we have one of the types of the stories we have generated here, just like a couple of slides. So this type of story that we select a specific point of time and we see how different pages cover this thing. So for example, tell me like any events that you was confused about, you have seen lately. So, anything.
For example, I was in Egypt last week, right? There was many events. I hear ten different stories about that event and the whole world.
Okay, what you're gonna have here?
Everyone is a story, the same story that happened from different perspectives.
Yeah. So this story will help you, and it will actually show you how the different perspectives from all the newspapers are. So here you will be presented with all the different screenshots from these newspapers. So for example, I have here in the backup slide something related to what you are saying actually. So I'm glad that I haven't taken it away. So, I'm sure that this is, I'm sure that this is what you have suffering about, right? There are many humanities are studying this. How the
tell us what this is for those who don't
speak. I'm going to mention this. So this is a screenshot or an image for a state newspaper in Egypt. And this states here are mentioned that millions of people go outside to for supporting Mubarak. This is during the beginning of the revolution, where actually millions of people were going against Mubarak. So many humanities studies, and this where I found actually this screenshot for this newspaper here, studies how the coverage of the newspapers differ based on their perspective or based on their they are with or against different parties. So one of the stories we have in here, it will help you in having all the perspectives at the same time. So it will help those humanities students or researchers to for this kind of story or study. So
I would make a question about that.
Right, but there, I think there's an important point that's being made. We're sampling
from within the collection. Yeah.
The collections are generated
by you need experts.
Well, they already have a point of view.
Yeah, you're right.
Yes. Okay. I'll come back to you.
Yeah, first of all, I would like to congratulate you on the work and actually keeping slice of history for future generations for you. My first question actually is kind of similar to what Dr. mentioned in terms of the, obviously the mementos themselves, you have the selection itself is coming from different sources. But you have one really important piece in which is related to media bias in terms of really telling the story so that it actually reflects the different perspective. So do you think, for example, that maybe your DSA, which by the way is very interesting, would actually include something that I'm not sure whether it would be automate that process. For example, for the source of the selection, because for example, depending on the media selection of the sources, you're going to get different perspective and different analysis, sometimes you have. You really have maybe opposite, in terms of perspective on the same issue. So, do you think, for example, like a future research where media bias could be considered as a way to enrich maybe the way that the mementos are selected?
I think if I get this correctly, so
Yasmin
you're asking like if we can get different perspectives or if we can like get perspective from a specific website. I'm sorry, just trying to.
Basically, I mean, it's probably both of what you said in terms of having enriching, not necessarily really have complete coverage of, of whatever.
Yeah. I just want to stress out again here because thanks for the notifying me on this. And we sample from within the collection, so we can go or partly can go through outside of the collection to get new perspectives or new things. And this is one of the future we have added in my future that we can suggest new city or eyes from the life of to be added to the collections, and then we can maybe get the whole pictures and so on. It will be at the end be based on how the curator want to have this or not, because this collection to have curators that manage this collection, but this can be added, and we have like two kinds of stories. One of them is you can select specific website or specific domain you want, like CNN, and if you want a story from CNN, so you will have this. And also, if you want to see specific point at a time from different website, you will have this as well. But from within the collection, part of your account.
But you can have a collection that had
information
from lots of different. I could create a collection that had news stories about the same. Let's say it's going to cover the political, stories about Donald Trump, right? So I'm going to pick from CNN, I'm going to pick from PBS, I'm going to pick from NPR, but I'm also going to pick from Fox News and Breitbart and a bunch of conservative things. So how do I pick a certain type of story?
Yeah,
I don't want the Fox News stories getting in the way of my...
You mean like for creating the tool, how do you select? Okay, so if you select a specific collection that you want to summarize, and you will have this...
So go to your quality plot where you have your quality equation.
Oh, so you mean in terms of, I thought that you were talking about how to read this. Okay.
The idea is what type of things can you allow the curator to do to create the type of story that they want to? Because you could create many types of stories from the same collection.
Yes. So the question again,
what types of things could you allow the curator to do? What parameters could you allow them to be able to generate different types of stories?
So can I answer this? I think it's not about the quality here. It's about the...
Well, it's not about quality, but it's something that could be incorporated into this equation.
Yeah, exactly. And actually, we have already some stuff that you can, as a creator, you can control. So, for example, if you have the URI, you can like choose which URI you want to restrain from. Also, the general stories that bring you some from the whole collection, you just have the ID of the collection. This is really what you need to know, or what the curator they need to know. And the other thing is that you can choose a specific date or a specific point of time or specific range as well.
I'm sorry, I want you to think a little bit broader over exactly what you did, right? I mean, you have parameters that curators can do now. But what could be added?
A lot of stuff actually, yeah. Okay, so that's why Dr. Nelson usually visits first. So yeah, the weight here can be changed, like in this equation. So this can be set as a parameter. For example, here, maybe on the, depending on the nature of the URI of the collection, also, as I remember from the off-topic page, the web something was collections that have very long time span. So there was a dramatic change of these pages. So as a method we have, we used the DS framework, we used the cosine and word count. Why a web kernel-based method may perform like better in such in these cases? So this can be a parameter, you know, like which method for detecting and so on. So there are many actually parameters that can be like left as an option for the creator to do. So
so one of the things that you allow the curator to do now is to limit the time range, right? You can allow them to say, okay, I only want one particular month out of this collection or one particular day out of this collection. What's the other dimension? But you have two dimensions, right, in your collection?
Yeah.
You have time and...
URI, but right now we have just one URI. We can provide them like multiple URI. So this is maybe also
And I think related to that, for instance, for example, maybe not down the road, you know, for the future, you know, perhaps different languages. So instead of using, for instance, for example, on English sources, you could use, you know, other languages. And then you would have really different
Especially with curator for Egyptian Russian collections, so I think they would be interesting to have a specified language like Arabic. Mm-hmm. Most of these collections are Arabic actually. Yeah,
one thing you could do here to expand on this, if you created a collection that was, you know, everything about Donald Trump, right? And talk about, you could add a dimension left wing to right wing with a variable that goes from 0 to 1, and you have some method for determining the orientation or position of a particular variable, right? And then you could allow the curator in generating the story to generate a left wing story, a right wing story, a center story, and you have a dimension of scoring page. So it's not just a matter of this is a a quality memento because it has all of its images and it's a deep link and all this kind of stuff. But you could say, all right, if I want a center story about this topic, I've got lots of things that are 0.9s and 0.8s. I need to have some 0.2s and 0.5s and things like that.
Yes, sure. Yeah, that can be added as well. Yeah,
other parameters actually can be edited. Or maybe hard sweating, as you sample out, like, you know, in the editing phase, you spit out, let's say, 15 stories from a story, 15 articles or something. And then they select, like, I don't like this one or this one. But start that out with something else that relates to the rest of the content or something.
Many performance measures. procedures for the methods we have used from the information retrieval. And this is what I started with, the trends in web archives. And the last thing here is reminding the read time of the web page. This is what we extract. We use library for extracting this, for ordering the pages by their time. So I hope I answered your question.
So another question I have is, so the archive it has lots of different types of collections. They have these event-based collections that you have studied and have developed stories for. But they also have these collections that are really based on archiving government web pages. So there's, you know, there's state governments that archive all their pages. So do you see how those type of collections could benefit from what you've developed?
Yeah, these collections can be actually in the 18 collections that we used for detecting, like testing the evaluation, the autonomic methods. So we found many collections of them were governmental, and we found actually autonomic in these collections. So at this point, definitely the autonomic tool or the cache related is going to have to do this. For the stories, well, I think this is needs to be studied. Like, we can, like, it's gonna be interesting for them to have a story from the state government collection for, you know, Virginia and so on. So I'm not sure about this regarding to the stories, generating stories from these collections, how much it will be interesting for them and so on. But maybe, like, I don't know, I think this needs to be tested. But at the level of the off-topic and many other stuff in the framework, like, you know, I think if they want, like, have summaries inside the collections, like maybe removing the logics and so on, definitely every year can be applied to these collections.
So, but what's your intuition about if you just took your code right now and ran it against, I think, the state of Maryland has their state government archives? Do you have any idea of what one of these stories might look like if you just ran your tool against one of those types of collections?
Yes, I think it will show you what's inside the collection. So it will do good in this, but just the narrative will be missing. But definitely it will show you what are the content in this collection. Yeah, because it's like just any other collection that we have to do.
So we can help provide collection understanding.
Yes, definitely.
Even if there's not a story.
Yes.
Involved.
Yes. Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Good. All right. So for kind of a more technical detail related to that, so you've developed some, you use a couple libraries to create good snippets, so to get the date and the file icon. And you said you use the newspaper library, which I assume would work well on articles.
Yeah,
so do you think that that would work well on, like, you know, the North Carolina Public Works webpage, or how well would some of those techniques work on non-article pages?
I don't know.
Thank you.
think they are already studying this. So instead of doing this manually, we would like introduce them once at a time to the students here that would help.
All right. So let's suppose the people at the Internet Archive. I mean, they've been tracking this. You're talking with them and so forth. They see this presentation and they say, this is awesome. We want to implement it as soon as possible next week. Right. But also, suppose Storify goes out of business tomorrow. How do you adapt the concepts in the DSA framework in a web that doesn't have Storify.com?
Yes. Actually, I see it is not a big problem because here the main contribution is how to select the pages that will be presented and pushed to Storify. Storify is just like interface that we put the URIs in to visualize, but the main contribution of this work here is the selection of this set of full pages. This is the step until, you know, like visualized by Storify. So this can be visualized by any different way. So
what are some of the different ways that you
There are actually many other tools. We just wanted to start with something that people are familiar with, but we can do this like ourselves. We can put whatever you know. Sorry?
Such as?
As you mean tools? As there's a DDT tool. It's very, very nice tool that provides you visualize the stories and put them in a timeline shape. So it's very good tool, and I think they were one of the Internet Archive people contacted me about this because I had a screenshot of this in the proposal and asking me about this actually, so like asking about it. So this one of the things also can be, we can use for visualizing the stories.
Could you use this in Facebook or Twitter?
To generate the story? Like.
All right, so we run your algorithm on a collection, we come up with 28 mementos that we think nicely summarizes the story. Now we've got, you know, set
you can
JSON.
Post them anywhere.
well, talk to me about where you push them.
Yeah, you can post them anywhere. The idea is like Facebook and Twitter, I think they, you mean posting the URIs, right? Like URI by URIs. So this is the main thing for Facebook and Twitter is that I think currently in their interface they don't allow like having submission of many URIs at the same time, or they can visualize the first one and the other one will be just listed as URIs. Yeah, so yeah, that's my answer. So if they have something in future that will have, you can like submit list of URIs, and I think they may have, so yeah. That's
what about possible. Something like Pinterest or something?
Yeah,
like
Pinterest.
That.
Can be it will be great actually in Pinterest for like creating the board or something. So yeah, it can be visualized by any way, any of them that has APIs that we can talk to, it can we can use.
Any other questions?
One more. Can you go to 117? 17. Yeah, that's right. So we talked a lot about, you know, the snippets and having the fab icon and the host name of the URIR here in the snippet. Do you see any disadvantage to doing it this way, in particular with the fab icon and the host name?
I'm sorry.
What information have you lost by replacing the fab icon and the host name?
The only thing that was there is all the stories that all repeated here are private. So this is the only thing that's missing, and this can be actually added in the description of something because we can edit the description. Is that these collections have been generated from archived collections.
that case, date should go there.
Yeah, we had actually another visualization. It's another option, but you know, it's just related to the tool that you can put the date here. Yeah. So we have to.
You have like user settings or something.
Yeah,
or
exactly.
Like
the day,
yes.
What you
want to
be showing.
So why do you call it DSA? Okay. So, it was a dark and stormy night, Snoopy. Yeah, and we're having here some stories. So, Dr. Mitchell. Yeah, I think you can explain better. So.
Well, I forget the original author, escapes my mind.
It's not, yeah.
Name, but popularized by Snoopy.
Yeah.
It was a dark and stormy night is considered the worst intro sentence for a story. And so there's actually a dark and stormy night bad story telling contest. It's considered a terrible way to begin a story. So not that these are great works of literature, they're just mementos arranged in time. So it's a little cute nod to even a bad story. A popular bad story. There's lots of bad stories. This is famous for being bad. Right. Any other questions? So we'll ask everyone, both committee, to